felt like I belong.
Well, I've just been given a 2-minute warning, so we're close. My name is Keith Horseman, and I'm the celebrant for Miles and Karen's wedding ceremony today. And I wanted to let you know that they have created a personalized ceremony with all of you in mind. They responded to questions I put to them about their relationship, and we use that to weave into this experience. So that you may mentally prepare, it will last about 35 minutes. They also want me to pass on to you that they like the idea of an unplugged and tweet-free ceremony. So just a reminder to mute your devices, stow them away, and really just capture how the moment feels and allow the photographer and videographers to capture how it looks. Also, at the beginning of the ceremony, I'm going to keep you standing for about 4 minutes as we affirm our couple. If any of you need to sit down, by all means, sit down. But I want you to know that I will invite you to be seated at the appropriate time. So you don't have to be wondering about that. Now, all of you are here because you are Karen and Miles friends. You're their inner circle. And as such, I would like to invite you to maybe turn and introduce yourselves to someone sitting around you you may not know, as you'll be celebrating with each other for the rest of the evening. And are you Jorge? Good to meet you. Keith. And Wendy. Good to meet you, Wendy.
Thank you.
You bet. Thank you. Well, all of you, the families and friends of Miles and Karen, you are the foundation upon which these two lives have been built. And they now look to you and having their back as they make this commitment to one another here today. So I have a few questions for all of you that I know have an obvious answer, but I believe our bride and groom would be inspired by hearing your voices. So I ask you, will you agree to stand beside them and never between them? Will you do this?
Yes.
Will you offer them your support, but not your judgment?
Yes.
And will you encourage them and honor this marriage?
Yes.
Well, by applause, let's affirm this beautiful couple. We need a witness to our lives. There's 7 billion people on the planet, and a true companion gives value to our survival. The universe is a huge place, and as near as we can tell, a Goldilocks condition of life exists, only in a very narrow band between ocean and sky on a small planet, in a middling solar system, amongst a middling galaxy, and over billions of other galaxies. The one true gift that we can agree to give one another is to make a home amongst all this vastness and rarity. For Miles and Karen, marriage means to trust willfully, forgive readily, and to celebrate their shared journey. It is not to fill in the gaps or the pieces of them that are wrong or inadequate, but to work in musical harmony with compassion, understanding, and an eye for a fresh beginning every morning. Marriage is an action that shows accountability and commitment to fostering a thriving and evolving relationship for decades to come. Marriage may very well be the most intense rite of passage for personal growth in our culture. Miles and Karen, in marriage, you're promising to care about everything, the good things, the bad things, the mundane things. All of it, all of the time, every day, you're saying to each other, your life will not go unnoticed because I will notice it. Your life will not go unwitnessed because I will be your witness. So I invite you to take a look at the crowd who have gathered here to revel in your I do's on this monumental day of promises. Take a deep breath. Bring them with you into this moment. You know today's going to fly by. But it's your memories that will travel with you for the rest of your lives. Karen and Miles are thrilled to have all of you here with them to celebrate one of the greatest days of their lives. You bring the dance. You carry a history with them. They've been shaped by your guidance and your influence. You are the reason they didn't elope. You are their inner circle and generous travelers. You've all made it here to Colorado's thin air, even thinner up here. You've made it to a culture of action sports and a front range with more breweries than Munich, Germany. Now, the Spanish name Colorado after the color red, color rojo, inspired by the state's 300 million year old red rocks. Well, red is also the color of fire and love. And so color rojo makes a great home for this wedding. I invite you to be seated. So Miles and Karen met at a music for game development meetup. Now, every once in a while, Miles takes time to compose electronic music, and he was also studying computer science. But the real motivating factor for him attending was that he could not stand to be in his apartment for 1 second more. It was an opportunity to develop a professional relationship with others. And at the same time, Karen was into 3D modeling, and she wanted to get into more of the coding side. of application development. She said, "The first thing I noticed about Miles was how quirky and spazzy he was. From the moment he walked in, he flipped open his laptop, started typing frantically, turning the computer every 5 seconds toward a couple sitting across from him, explaining what he was working on. They seemed a bit annoyed, but I thought it was endearing." She said, "I caught his eye from across the room, and he shyly looked away." Well, a few minutes later, Miles joked to the person next to him that they should play musical chairs. And then he took the first chance he could to sit next to Karen. He said, "Karen's behavior revealed a person who didn't judge others for being goofy or passively awkward. And since then, I've learned so much more that makes me love her." For their first date, Miles offered to teach Karen how to code. Not a scene of a first date you usually see from a romance novel. She said, "It really went well for a little while. I thought it was cute how frazzled and frustrated he would get over the uncooperative school computers, but he hadn't dated much before, and we ended up having a few really bad miscommunications. He sort of accidentally told me to go home. We both thought the other didn't like us." So Miles was really surprised when she later messaged him, asking if he wanted to get together again. Their second date went much better. They hung out at her apartment, joked around, ran in the rain, and at one point, Miles dashed out into the middle of the street barefooted to collect a part that had fallen off a car, which he used as an umbrella walking back in. Now, Karen adored his humor and his imagination. And later they found shelter in her car as they talked about their lives. So Karen and Miles fell in love by chance, but they're here today because of a choice. They've chosen to be with someone who makes them think, who makes them smile, and who makes every day brighter. Now, everyone who has ever loved us becomes part of who we are. Marriage is more than two individuals partnering for life. It's also the coming together and the merging of family and friends. And Miles and Karen cherish you, their connection to the past, proclaimers of the present, and their hope for the future. Shannon, Randy, and Alan, you have helped to shape Karen into the person she is today. From a very young age, you showed her the beauty of a close family, good friends, love, learning, and hard work. Step by step, you played a significant role in building her confidence and values and teaching her responsibility, lending her support, and encouraging her to follow her dreams. Karen said, "My mom taught me how to be smart with money and managing my time. She is one of the first people I talk to for advice when I'm upset. In a way, she's kind of a helicopter mom, but I love her for it because she takes care of me and she gives great advice. And through her, I've also learned how to stand up for my own opinions. She is always there for me in a moment's notice and is honestly the best mom I could ask for. My dad worked hard to take care of all of us and always made sure we had more than we needed. He is a lot of fun, and he gave me my sense of humor and quirkiness. We've grown closer as I've grown older, and I'm really grateful for that because I've always know that he is someone I can go to for support and a good laugh when I'm feeling down." And she said, "While growing up, my brother was always my best friend, and we still are as close as ever. Even though he's younger, he was always more mature and constantly questioning my worldview by making me see things in a new way. Many of my beliefs stem from Alan because of the respect I have for him. In some ways, we are total opposites. Alan is logical and brainy, and I'm often driven by my emotions. He balances me out. Miles and my brother are quite alike, and I think the traits I was looking for in a life partner were modeled after my brother. Well, Randy, Shannon, and Alan, Miles has immense appreciation for Karen, the one who is the love of his life. And Michelle, Jorge, and Andy, from an early age, you have always been Miles' biggest supporters. You taught him principles that have guided him to this day. You provided wisdom in his endeavors, and you mentored him on the road to adulthood. Miles said, "Both of my parents helped me grow up to have an independent mind and to think critically and to pay attention to the details. In addition to this, my dad gave me a respect and desire for success. And my mom gave me the ability to step back from something and to observe it without bias." Jorge and Wendy, and Michelle and Jay, and Andy, Karen can't express enough gratitude for the love that you have already shown her. So, Miles and Karen consider themselves lucky to be welcomed not only into wonderful families, but into an inspiring and supportive network of friends. You are their true friends. You know them as they are. You understand where they've been, and you celebrate who they have become. They echo what Albert Schweitzer once said. Sometimes our light goes out, but is blown into flame by an encounter with another human being. Each of us has cause to think with deep gratitude of those who have ignited that spark within us. Miles and Karen, do you pledge to help each other to develop your hearts and minds, cultivating generosity, integrity, patience, enthusiasm, and wisdom as you age and undergo the various ups and downs of life, and to transform them into the path of love, compassion, and joy? And do you pledge to maintain the awareness that life and people are imperfect? Life brings changes. Will you strive to be open-minded and appreciative of all the good things that life and your partner do bring, and to remain optimistic that you can achieve your greatest potential and lasting happiness? Wonderful. Well, Karen and Miles are teammates, partners, and equals. They are friends who talk, listen, and support one another's ideas and beliefs. They don't punish each other for misunderstanding, but they pause first to hear a new perspective. Through their relationship, they have experienced growth and change, and they have adapted together. Karen said, "We are weird and hyper, and we can prolong a minuscule topic and discuss it exhaustively." Well, Miles and Karen have helped each other to stay motivated through thick and thin, and they provide balance to each other. Karen discovered in Miles a motivated, intelligent, head in the clouds, and patient partner who loves debating and asking why a lot. He appreciates when people are honestly real with him. He will sometimes put in 80 hours a week between work and his graduate studies, and he passionately loves every minute of it. Karen said, "I can talk to him and express myself about anything or even just rant, and he doesn't try to shut me down or tell me that I'm overreacting. If he says something that is wrong or makes no sense to me at all, I have learned to tell him and not to just nod and smile. Miles loves to hear a new perspective. He spent most of his childhood as a self-proclaimed hermit, and his years of introversion have led him to some interesting social interactions where he is unaffected by pop culture. Miles moves mountains for Karen in his care and his concern. She gets a kick out of when he regularly attempts a few styles of throat singing, or when he uses made-up words, like instead of razors, he calls it a scraggle chopper. She said, one time he was sleep talking and he told me he wanted to be in the same namespace as me. For those of you who don't speak programming language, that is C++ for I want to cuddle. So Miles discovered in Karen an enthusiastic, passionate, smart, and witty partner who is incredibly discerning and a character of intentions, who doesn't judge someone for being goofy, nor for making jokes in good spirit. She freely shares her opinion, and she also is a constant asker of why. Miles said, she is an amazing planner and a critical thinker. I love her free mind. We don't judge each other for our quirks and oddities, and she holds her ground. Nobody can tell her what to think unless they can genuinely convince her in a way that accounts for her knowledge and past experience into a rigorous standard. He said she is willing to hold a conversation that digs into all of that, into the interest of learning. Karen is fun-loving, and he laughs at the way she impersonates his actions of speech, revealing the mistakes he makes and when a critique is in order. In his book, The Road Less Traveled, Scott Peck reminded the world that love is an action. It's a verb. It's not something you feel or something you've heard. It's a free exercise of choice. When we love someone, our love becomes real only through our exertion. We take an extra step. We go an extra mile. Love is not effortless. To the contrary, love is effortful. Well, Karen experiences Miles' love through little everyday efforts, driving around with him aimlessly while listening to music, having late night conversations about life, and telling him right away when he's being a dummy. Miles said, Karen has helped me to better understand who I am by spotting when I'm uncomfortable or upset but won't admit it to myself. She helps me work out what is bothering me. I often come out of these conversations with a completely different outlook and new ideas about what I would like to do in the future. And Karen knows of Miles' love with his caring and doting. She knows when he remembers her birthday or their anniversary, and remembering dates requires a conscious effort on his part. Like all men, I think. She knows when he helps her find the stuff that she loses track of. Karen said, he teaches me new things all the time, and he helps me overcome worries that turn out to be not so important. So for Miles and Karen, nothing can be, will ever be the same again. They're not merged into each other, but rather from now on they go in the same direction, agreeing not to leave each other behind or lonely or discouraged. The strengths and frailties that they each bring to this marriage will make them rich indeed. Jim Croce was a folk musician who wrote a song called Time in a Bottle. This was very popular at wedding ceremonies in the 70s. And one line of his song reads, "If I had a box just for wishes and dreams that would never come true, the box would be empty except for the memory of how they were answered by you." Well, today, Miles and Karen are going to begin a new marriage tradition in front of all of you here, where they're going to begin to fill a box with all the wishes and dreams they have for one another. Now, Karen's mother and Miles' mother, representatives of the families, have a wish for their kids, a happy and a rich marriage. So I now invite Michelle and Shan to come forward with elements of this new marriage tradition, which contains a box, their marriage time capsule. And this box now contains their favorite bottle of wine, this year anyways, and letters that they've written to each other in honor of today. As their annual tradition, each year on their anniversary, they will share the wine and they will give each other another letter. So as they go through their married life, this will become an ever-expanding treasure of their written love for one another. Thank you, Michelle and Shannon. Now, Karen and Miles, if you should ever find your marriage enduring insurmountable hardships, as a couple, open this box immediately. Drink the wine. And then separate and read all the letters you wrote to one another. By reading these letters, you will be able to reflect upon all the wonderful reasons why you fell in love and chose to marry. For this is a box for replenishing your love. And you can always replenish the beverage. Like good wine, a great love will deepen and mature with age. Miles and Karen, you knew you found yourselves in love with one another within the first 6 months of your relationship, as the culmination of your experiences together showed you the dawning sensation of balance and shared love, the beauty and joy of being on the same team, and learning how your puzzle pieces fit together. Miles, your moment of clarity happened when you and Karen were out for a drive in Boulder, and you ended up sitting at the bottom of the outdoor steps at your old apartment. Warmed by the sunlight, Karen fell asleep in your lap, listening to you ramble about computer science. You sat there for a long time, and if you could, you would immortalize the feeling you had at that moment. And Karen, your moment happened a little over 2 years into your relationship, where one night he pulled you close to him, and he promised he would never let you down. Even though you knew it was an impossible promise, it made an impression. And you knew then that he was the one. Miles and Karen, during this evolutionary process, you shared values and goals. You learned to treat one another with compassion over fairness, supporting each other to make both of your lives better. You found a complementary partner who was exhilarating and off the charts, and you wanted that reality to last for the rest of your lives. Now, old cowboy wisdom says, the best way to enter into marriage is with ignorance and confidence. It's profound and incredible to choose to commit yourself and your love to another for a lifetime. Before this moment, you've been many things to each other: friend, companion, teacher, and lover. Now you will say the words that will take you across the threshold of life, making you partners in marriage.
Karen, I will always love you, whether you're happy, sad, angry, or excited. In good times, I will always and eagerly goof around with you, enjoy peaceful moments, and try not to take figurative speech too literally. In bad times, I will be there for you to protect and comfort you, and to remind you that you're not alone. Even in busy times, I will find, make, or steal time to spend with you, and I will try to bring something special to that time every day. I promise to ceaselessly encourage you and back you up. Even when all seems lost, I promise to be lost with you because you are the best partner I could possibly imagine having in any time, good or bad. Together, we will weather all frustration, tragedy, and even boredom to seek out that which is new, strange, and exciting, meaningful, and beautiful.
I'll never forget when we first met. I told you I was scatterbrained. Your response was so refined. You said, "That's a terrible way to describe the whirlwind of thought inside your mind." All the times I've overreacted, you called it a side effect of passion that you would never want to change. I guess we're both a little fragile in the most endearing ways, and if someone were to call us ditzy, I'd call it a Saturday. I promise to be the fun in your life and all the adventure you seek. I'll always make you leave your room, because the outside world's not that bleak. I'll make you laugh because I'm just that funny and be there when you're weak. I'll push you to express your thoughts and to follow your goals and dreams. I'll point you in the right direction when things aren't what they seem. And sometimes I'll give you a reality check too, because that's just what friends do. I'm here because there's nowhere else. You're the one I need. You've taken care of me and shown only generosity, never greed. And you wouldn't stop at anything, as far as I can see. We've built a life together and a future that's just as strong. And this corny poem doesn't cut it, but I know where I belong.
You proposed to Karen at Niagara Falls, the Canadian side. You had been carrying the ring in your pocket during the entire trip, not knowing exactly when you would ask. Everywhere you went, the throngs of tourists were inescapable. But when you saw the falls for the first time, you were overcome with now. You've both chosen to wear rings as a reminder of these promises you just made. People often say that wedding bands are a perfect circle with no beginning and no end. But these rings did have a beginning. The ore was formed a long time ago, deep within the earth. And eventually a series of lucky events caused them to rise to the surface, where someone dug them up. Metal was liquefied in a furnace at thousands of degrees, molded, cooled, and painstakingly polished. Something beautiful was made from these raw elements. And your love is like that. It comes from humble beginnings, but through a combination of serendipity and effort, imperfect beings shape it into something extraordinary. And Andy, you may present these rings. And Miles, please repeat after me. Karen, this ring I give to you. It is my personal gift, my promise of love and trust, and pride that you are my wife. And Karen, please repeat after me. Miles, this ring I give to you. It is my personal gift. My promise of love and trust. And pride that you are my husband. Let us stand. Miles and Karen, remember that a successful marriage not only depends on finding the right person, but also on being that right person. May you always have a special sense of your mission in life together, and may you never tire of the endless possibilities of exploring your shared existence. And many years from now, may you look at one another and be able to say, with you, I have lived the life I have always wanted to live. With you, I have become the person I have always longed to be. So now that you have spoken the words and performed the rites that unite your lives, we now, by the power of your love and commitment, declare your marriage to be almost official. All right, Miles, you want to turn away? And so now it is our honor to introduce you for the first time, a couple who have just taken a drastic tax avoidance measure. Mr. and Mrs. Miles and Karen Latre, husband and wife. You may kiss your bride. And Miles and Karen, I'll invite all of you for cocktails, I think at the other end of the floor.
Just left, guys.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, we're going to be rolling into the toast right now, so if we can get everybody to quiet down a bit. Really helps. Some people aren't as loud as I am on a mic, so if we can get everybody to quiet down real quick. There we go. Okay, so we're going to start off this evening with the father of the bride. Randy, come on out.
All right, well, I just want to thank everybody, first of all, for coming tonight. I know some of you came from some pretty long distances, so we're glad you can make it. Karen always wanted to have a fancy wedding, and you can't beat this, so. And I think this was Miles' dream from the time he was a little boy, too. He wanted the princess wedding. And, so you're all helping to fulfill a couple of bucket list wishes here tonight, so thanks for coming. As you know, it's traditional for the father of the bride to start off with a toast. And I first just want to start off and say that how much we love Karen and Miles, and we're proud of you guys, and we wish you the best of luck. They've recently moved to Seattle, too, and we've had to plan some of this wedding from Seattle, and
awesome.
Best of luck to you guys in your future. This is also, however, an opportunity for the father of the bride to get even with his daughter for all of the heartache, agony, misery, and pain that she's caused her poor daddy throughout her childhood years. And so I've compiled this list. And get through this as quickly as possible.
Oh, God.
Volume 1, Chapter 1. thank you. No, you guys are going.
No, just kidding.
The real list is much longer. But I would like to share just a couple of short stories with you about Karen. When she was a little girl, she wanted to grow up and marry her brother. And I believe she maintained this position for about, until she was about 16 or 17. At which time she simply changed it to, I'm going to marry someone who is exactly like my brother. Now, for those of you who know both Miles and Alan, damn.
Yeah.
So, Karen grew up and she graduated from Casper College and she decided to move to Denver and go to film school. Not one of her better decisions in life. And so we moved her down there and co-signed on an apartment for her. And you know, you guys know Karen. She's a very sociable person. She's like, no, I can't do this. I can't be by myself. I'll never find any friends. I'll never find a roommate. I'll never find anybody. I'm gonna die. And we're like, no, Karen's gonna be fine. No, I'm never gonna find anybody. I'm never gonna find a roommate. I'm never gonna find friends. I'm gonna die. True story. I don't think we got as far as Cheyenne on our way back to Casper before she calls us up and says, hey guys, I found a roommate. LOL. It was her maid of honor, Savannah. So she dated a couple of losers for a while and then she met Miles. Now, my first impression of Miles was pretty good. I mean, he seemed like a nice kid and all. But I gotta tell you this about Miles. This was a young man with a one-track mind. And I think y'all know what I'm talking about. Yeah, computers. I don't think this dude has been more than 2 feet away from his computer at any given time in his life. And that includes showering, going to the bathroom, sleeping, probably a few other things we don't want to mention tonight. But I did have a good impression of him. I mean, when I first met him, he seemed a little bit like Sheldon from The Big Bang Theory. I mean, he wasn't quite that Asperger-y, but he had a little bit of Sheldon in him. And I can't remember, we were having breakfast somewhere when we met, right? Didn't we go out to breakfast? Yeah. It was like, I don't know, breakfast at Denny's or something. I guess Tiffany's was closed, I don't know. Ooh, tough crowd. Look at the young people. What's he talking about, breakfast at Tiffany's? Tiffany's doesn't serve breakfast, what's he talking about? So, we were having breakfast with Miles in his computer. And I don't remember what Miles had, but his computer had a virus because he was telling us about some sort of problem he was having with either the computer itself or some software program he was writing. And Shannon decided to pop off because, well, she's been married to me for 30 years and can't control herself. But she's like, well, Miles, I think it's an ID10T problem. He'd never heard that before. And she's like, oh, you know, it's an ID10T problem. Keyboard to human interface issue we got going on here. He wasn't getting it. We're like, Miles, it's a joke. Think about it, you know, ID10T. He's like, no, that doesn't make any sense. And she's like, no, it's a joke. Just think about it. So he's writing it down, and he's looking at it. We're like, no, Miles, just look at it. It's a joke. He's like, I know. Well, let me figure it out. So the ID is like some type of identification system, and the 10 is using base 10 mathematics, and I'm thinking, oh, this kid's sense of humor sucks. Now, Miles' IQ is probably double what mine is. But I'll bet it took Actually, come to think of it, that may not be that impressive, but that's a bad example, but I digress. But I'll bet it took him at least 10 or 15 minutes to figure out that I-D 10 T spells idiot. Wait a minute. Some of you people didn't get that? Wow. We got a room full of computer software engineers. But anyway, we feel like Miles has now been totally exposed to the Hattlestead insanity, and he's completely hattletized at this point. And I just want to say in closing that I'm glad that Karen has finally found her Sheldon. And I don't think that a father could ask for a better guy to kidnap his daughter, to marry his daughter. And so, to Karen and Alan, everybody. Damn it, Randy, you were doing so good to that point. You stupid ID Tenji. To Karen and Miles, everybody.
Very awesome. Let's hear it out there for Randy. And then if we can get Andy to come down, the best man, same spot, that's where we can pick you up on video.
Where's your... Oh, God. Oh, no.
It's a partial. You can really tell my brother's character from the fact that he said, oh, no, it's fine. You can just swing it. Yeah. Just swing it. Just make some bullet points and just kind of say them however you want. Yeah. No biggie. Yeah, people don't expect it. Yeah. I remember that
he used to only wear cargo shorts and t-shirts everywhere. And, that was his style, because he didn't think about it. When he did think about it, or when somebody brought it up, it wasn't, you know, what he was wearing didn't matter. It was more about, why do people care if it matters? Is it, what's the philosophy behind that? What's the deeper problem in society that they care about fabric on bodies? It's just strange. Anyway, no. But what's really, really ironic, and I actually found this out tonight, he works in the fashion section of Amazon. And I think Karen's the only way that could have happened. I'm not entirely convinced he was at the interview. I think they put together a Mission Impossible. So, yeah. But no, in the same line, though, I think that Karen and Miles are the best fit that I could not think of, because I didn't actually know someone like Karen existed. Because I'm about as isolated as he is. I'm just more social in the social circle. We're two sides of the same coin, or genetics, or whatever. So, yeah. But there's no other pairing where Miles, I don't see any other way Miles actually would have come out of the isolated thinking within his own structures and going around in circles and things like that. And Karen kind of broke that open, and now he's flying all over the place, you know, like Seattle. So, yeah. But yeah, I just wanted to say that I'm really, really happy that you found that in your life, and that so far it's gone great. I can only see it going better, you know. I think she's created a huge base in your life where you were able to deal with everything you need to deal with. You've improved. She's improved. I think you're both like the healthiest thing that could happen to each other. So yeah, and so I'd like I just like some acknowledgement for them in the sense that they went through a lot of struggles early on, and I know that there was just Miles struggling with school, Karen struggled with school, they both struggled with school. There were a lot of different struggles, health struggles, all kinds. And the fact they were able to get through that means that I don't really know what else, what could damage them. So to me, it's a sign of invincibility. So, cheers.
Very nice. Let me turn that down a bit. There we go. We're looking for the bride's brother, Ellen, to come on out.
All right, for those who don't know me, most of you do, I'm the brother of the bride. And I also picked the groom. See, Karen thinks that she picked Miles, but she didn't. I picked Miles. Karen and I, we grew up together, so her decisions are subconsciously influenced by my opinions. Karen said yes to Miles at Niagara Falls, but I said yes to Miles when he told me that he could tell if there was a Spaniard in the room via his sense of smell. And that's when I said, yep, this one will do. I picked Miles because I could tell just how compatible the two of them were. I know because for a while I lived in their closet. It's not a joke. It's not just obvious things like how they'll confine themselves for an entire weekend to develop some game. It's like, you know, little things as well. For instance, they each know how to cook one meal. Which between the both of them makes two meals. We'll go hiking in the mud and they'll both wear dress shoes. And Miles will ruin his shoes and we'll have to get him new ones. You might think, how difficult can it be to put shoes on a man? Well, Miles has size 15 feet, so it turns out really, really difficult. It takes all day. Between Karen's celiac and Miles' hernia, it turns out that even their abdominal distress is a mutual attribute. But compatibility isn't just commonalities. They also have like a really great back and forth. You know, they sort of springboard off one another. When it's Karen's turn, you know, she'll tell Miles what to do. And when it's Miles' turn, he'll do it. And if that isn't love, then I don't know what is. So to Karen, to Miles, to compatibility, and to the man that made it all happen, which is me.
That's awesome. Okay, we're gonna ask the groom's mom, Michelle, to come on out. It is your turn.
I actually didn't know I was doing this. Okay, I heard there wasn't enough time. That doesn't mean I talk a lot, but I do. Okay. So, I'm the weird person in the family. I'm the extrovert. So it's been very strange to be raising an introvert. So I'm going to tell a story because I wasn't prepared. You told me there wasn't time for me. Okay, good. So Miles was 3. We took him to a French school because we thought he'd get along there for reasons that don't need explaining. But he wasn't this mild-mannered man when he was 3. He was a terror. And a really big kid, and he was nicknamed Loublon. Within 3 days of arriving at the French school, which means white wolf, because he would strike and run. No, this is not a joke. So the third day of school was a Monday, and I show up, and the kids are three, and we're waiting for the kids to come out. And these two women are telling, they figure out who Miles is, and, oh, Miles is her new boyfriend. And everything inside me. Now, I'm a really open mom. I'm not protective, but everything inside me said, what do you mean? He's not ready. Get away. Right? So, but I'm like asking what's going on. Miles comes out, and he's so tired. And these little girls come out, and they're like, oh, what, Miles? Oh, what? And he's not paying attention. I said, Miles, are you okay? Yeah, I'm just really tired. Okay, well, say bye to your friends. They're saying goodbye. You know, teaching, like, social etiquette. And he goes, Mom, I'm so tired. I'm like, and these girls, they're crying. And I'm like, Miles, they're crying. And he's like, I'm so tired. So, but anyway, so my whole life, no, his whole life, I've been worried about what was going to happen to this really good-looking kid who had no idea he was cute. He still doesn't. So will somebody tell him? So anyway, he has no idea. And I've been waiting for some woman to have him for lunch his whole life. Like, I thought he was a sitting duck because he just had no idea. And I, Karen, thank you for saving him. Oh my God. Oh my God, you're the perfect woman. I just want to tell you, I can breathe. No, really. But no, you guys are actually, I don't mean that in a bad things were going to happen way. You guys are awesome. You're both extremely powerful human beings. I love how introspective you are and how you examine yourselves. And that is the only thing in life that's going to really have you be unconquerable. And nothing's gonna stop you. I've grown to love you, Karen, and I've never had a daughter. And I'm so excited. We're gonna have a girl. So thank you so much. And Miles, I'm so proud of you and of the wisdom that you had and that you trust yourself enough to know that even though she's the first girl that you were really serious about, to know she was the one and not be afraid, you know? In the world we live in, we're in a world of shoppers. I'm so proud of you for not being that and for, like, knowing what you want and creating it. I could never have wanted anything more for you. I don't have anything to worry about, anything. Thank you both. I love you, and I'm so certain that this bliss will continue, and I see you blissful, and I, oh my gosh, you know, if only I had done it, but I didn't do it, you did it. Thank you.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, let's give a big round of applause to all the toasters this evening. And with that being said, everybody raise those glasses in the air and toast to your bride and groom. And then we had one more person that wanted to say something. The most important person around here this evening. One of the two. Here you go, Miles.
Thank you.
I got you.
Now, I really admire everyone who came up here for being able to memorize that much, or even, wasn't even off memory, holy, like, wow, guys, thank you so much. There are a lot of you here today. There's so many of you here today. I know for a fact, I didn't know this many people when I met Karen. But I'd like to thank everyone here. I'd like to thank everyone here for being here, and I wanna address you one by one. So, Karen, thank you for being there. when I was lost and I thought I would never have anyone, for staying the course when life got hard, and for helping me out of my crabby hermit crab shell. You've been my guide, my happiness, and my everything since the day I met you. Thank you, Mom and Dad, for working so hard to turn that crazy, mischievous child into a non-criminal. And thank you for always pushing me to get out there. I know you pushed me. You pushed me really hard to get out there, and you continue to push me even when I was really, really, really forceful about not experiencing anything new at all. Shannon and Randy, you've always welcomed me into your family as one of your own, and I really do feel like my quirky personality fits in pretty well.
We want money.
Well, yeah. You can do that. We can do that too. No, I am the lucky one, seriously. Thank you, Andy, for being my best man, my best friend, my closest friend growing up, my social role model. You've always been supportive and shown me how to get along with people. Our time together, playing and designing video games and discussing at length how things work and how they should work, it was a really, really great part of my childhood. And it made me feel more understood. At the time I picked my groomsmen, I didn't have any many super close friends aside from Karen's. So thank you, Karen, for letting me borrow people. Now, Alan, I have so much respect for you. I have so much respect because you're like the version of me that is smart and not dumb. That's very special. You will tell me when my ideas are completely implausible, but you let me drag you along with it just for a little bit. I really appreciate that. Thank you. Matt, when it comes to the jokes, you bring the big guns. You can always make Karen and I laugh all the time. You can carry the longest, you can carry the most ridiculous joke for an unbelievable amount of time, and I love it. It is amazing. You've been one of our closest friends since the time I met Karen. And to my recent friends and coworkers, thank you so much for being here. You guys have been a really important part of what made my work fun and exciting, and it's really good to have you guys here. Thank you so much to everyone for showing up here today to share this day with us. That's all.
Okay, cool. Turned up a little bit for you there. Okay, folks, we're going to pin the bride's dress up a little bit, so we're just going to play a couple songs, and then after that, we're going to go into the cake and the first dances. Gentlemen, we're going to invite the bride and groom over to cut their cake at this time. Paparazzi is welcome, so come on down. Anybody that wants to come on down. Just watch out for the guys with the big cameras. We don't want anybody getting in the way of those. Other than that, everybody's welcome to come on over if they'd like. Where would you like them? Over back in the back? Okay. You guys want to go in the back? Is that okay? Okay, guys. So, let's make sure this is unpinned. Which area would you like to cut? A middle? Okay. Oh, okay. Well, yep. Oh, yeah, it's already got it done. Okay, guys, here you go. So if you would just set your, yeah, go ahead and grab the knife together at the same time. Yep, put the There you go, the spatula down there. And just set it on the cake and then look out here to your paparazzi and smile around and give everybody a smile. There they go. Uh-oh, looks like they, then you grab your spatula together, guys. And you may need your knife as well to coax that out of there. Sometimes they get stuck pretty good. So you might want to grab your knife as well. Yeah, sometimes you gotta double trouble it. Hey, it happens all the time. I do these all the time and I gotta give instructions every time. Yeah, that cake there likes to keep a hold. There you go. He's got it, ladies and gentlemen. There you go. Go ahead and chop that into two pieces there, or some smaller pieces, guys. Just enough to feed each other. And then if you guys would wait, oh, there you go. Perfect. Ladies and gentlemen, let's give them a big aw for being nice over there. Okay, guys, come on out for your first dance. Ladies and gentlemen, everybody could please put their hands together and welcome your bride and groom out to the dance floor for their first dance. Ladies and gentlemen, let's hear it out there for your entertainment and bride and groom. We're going to have Miles stick around real quick for a dance with his mother, so come on out. Let's hear it out there. For a mother and a son now. Now we're gonna ask the bride to come out and have a dance with her dad. Gentlemen, let's hear it out there for the bride and her father. At this time, we need all the unmarried ladies out to the dance floor. Oh, we got two songs going. We can only have one. I need all the unmarried ladies out to the dance floor. All the unmarried ladies. Where it works for you, my friend, either in for you. Okay, ladies, so where's my, there it is. I'm gonna have all the ladies come down this way. All the single ladies, if you have one at your table that's not coming out, raise your hand, we'll come get her. You ladies can come stand down at this end. And I'm gonna bring Karen down this way. Karen, if you would, look around, see if there's any cheaters out there. Well, there's one. There's a cheater. Anybody else? This one right here? Yes, this one right here. Both of them? Come on, ladies, let's go for a ride. Come on, girls. Oh, look. Well, you guys can point at each other. You might as well both go. Come on. Okay, looks like we're good. We good over there? Okay, ladies, so everybody crunch up and get close together. Put your hands in the air like you just don't care. That's pretty close. 1, 2, 3. That's awesome. That's the shortest throw I've ever seen. Okay, so now we need all the single gentlemen to the same spot. All the single gentlemen to the same spot, please. We need our bride to take a break right here. Oh, sorry. Okay, hold on. Let me talk you through this real quick. We got any more single gentlemen in the house? Here comes one. Right there, a bartender. Is there anybody that you know out there that should be coming over here? And they're all, I don't know them that well. Karen, can you help us out here? Any guys that's supposed to come out here? Oh yeah, they're coming. People are sending them on over. Okay, so we're getting ready here, ladies and gentlemen, but before we start, oh, we got more coming. There we go. Okay, so before we start this show, I've got to ask everybody a question out here. Who out here tonight thinks that he should take that off with his hands? Who out here tonight thinks he should take it off with his teeth? Well, with that being said, I guess they want you to take it off with your teeth. So I put on a little song on here to make you get in the mood to take that off with your teeth. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, he's going in. They said with the chompers, buddy. There he goes, ladies and gentlemen, he's in with the chompers. I didn't think that was supposed to happen until later, but here it goes. Oh, his glasses are steamed up. There we go, ladies and gentlemen. He has it. Oh, 1, 2, 3. And we got some divers. Uh-oh, we're going to have to find another Karen, I guess.